brothers. The older of two brothers, Maurice Friedberg, grew up in Yaroslav, a town in the southeastern corner of Poland, close to the Soviet Ukraine. His family owned a lumber business. When Nazi Germany concluded the non-aggression treaty with the Soviet Union, this paved the way for Adolf Hitler to attack Poland 1 week later on September 1st. One of the issues that the two newfound allies agreed on was to divide Poland. Maurice's family lived in the eastern part. The Nazis treated Jews in this part of Poland a little differently from the occupied zone.
One morning, a couple of Nazi soldiers and local collaborators appeared in our apartment, and they gave us 5 minutes to get ready, and they deported us to the other side of the Sun River, which was to become the Soviet zone of occupation. I clearly remember an example of Nazi humor. There was a roadside sign which said in German, Nach Palestina, to Palestine.
For several months, Maurice and his family lived in Tarnopol with his aunt and her family. They had no news of what was going on in Poland. They hoped to rejoin the rest of their extended family still left behind.
The Russian authorities asked all the refugees who came from the other side, who expressed their preference, the preference of being to remain a Soviet citizen or to go back to the places from which they were ejected by the Nazis, which is what we chose to do. One night they appeared and they read our names and they said, you'll have your wish carried out. And they took us to the railroad station, put us in cattle cars, and we were supposed to go to the other side of Sun River, but instead when the train began to move, it became obvious that we were moving in the direction of east rather than west, and east was Russia. Nobody knew where the hell we were going and why. And we ended up in what was then Sverdlovsk province. There was a lumber procurement barracks, and that's where I got picked up.
Soon thereafter, Maurice realized they were prisoners in a Soviet forced labor camp.
They got us all together, and they said, we'll be working here for the needs of the Soviet state, and you better get it in your mind that if you work hard, we'll feed you. If you don't work hard, we won't feed you, and then you'll starve to death, and we'll bury you here, because there is plenty of room for all of you, and that is the way it is with people who are trying to resist the needs of the Soviet state.
Maurice remembers a particular incident in the first morning that everyone was sent to work.
This uncle of mine, being a traditional Orthodox Jew, decided that he would first say his prayers. And as he was saying his prayers, the secret police commander came in, took out a watch from his pocket, and said, there is no way you will get to work on time. So we are going to send you to a different camp. And they sent him to a stricter camp with a solitary, with common criminals, and he was beaten there by the common criminals, so much so that when he came back, he was insane. And I remember there was a psychiatrist among the inmates, and he talked to him, and he shrugged his shoulders, and he said, there's nothing I can do for him here. And he went out one day and he never came back.
I'd like to say that this testimony, Maurice's family never found out what happened to his uncle, Ephraim. When Nazi Germany attacked the Soviet Union, all Jews were suddenly freed from forced labor and left to fend for themselves. Maurice and his family went to Jambul, Kazakhstan, where they lived until the war ended. I'd like to say something about this particular testimony. I should have warned you at the beginning. Oh, excuse me. I should have said in the beginning, he is blind when we're doing the interview, so that is why you didn't see him actually looking at an interviewer. He's also the father of one of our key historians at the museum, and after the war ended up, I believe, here in Ohio, and was a professor of Soviet studies at one of the local Ohio universities.